I'd like to invite the President of the Legislative Council, the Honourable Bruce Atkinson, to the stage.
Well, good evening on this very chilly September evening, but welcome, a very warm welcome to the Parliament of Victoria, to this iconic building, which is not just iconic in terms and important in terms of its architecture, but also because it is this place where we debate ideas, we work on issues, laws, visions for the future of Victoria. This Parliament House is built on land that was also important to the Aboriginal people, the First Nations of Victorians who used this area as part of their system of governance, as part of their celebration of culture. And it is a great pleasure tonight to welcome any elders, past or present, who may be with us this evening. It is a very important evening. This is one of the events that the Speaker and I have probably looked forward to more than any other. Because we are not just recapturing a moment in history that was so important, but we are also recognising how that continues to inspire our thinking and our sense of what we need to do in going forward as a community, as an inclusive community. And this petition demonstrates at an early stage people power in this great state, the progressiveness of many Victorians at that time, and unfortunately, the lack of progressiveness of some of the gentlemen who occupied the Legislative Council, which happens to be my House of Parliament, to my eternal shame. It's interesting that whilst women did get the vote in 1906 here, they continued to vote for men in grey suits up until about 1933, when we had Miss Millie Peacock elected, the wife of a three times Premier. And then 4 years later, Ivy Webber was elected as the second woman. And then again, there was quite a hiatus until we had more women come into this Parliament, make an outstanding contribution to the laws and to that vision that we have in government here in Victoria. I am delighted tonight to have all of you here as guests of the Parliament to celebrate, to commemorate, to acknowledge the importance of that petition 125 years ago. But I'm particularly delighted to welcome the Chief Justice, Marilyn Warren. We have members of the Consular Corps, we have some members of Parliament here. But indeed our chief guest, and some panellists as well that the Speaker will introduce a little later. But our chief guests tonight, the Governor, Linda Dessau, and her husband, Anthony Howard. Linda Dessau has had such a distinguished career in public office. Certainly, as one of the leading jurists in this state, and indeed beyond this state in Hong Kong, culminating in appointment and great success, the wisdom she brought to the Family Court of Australia, a particularly difficult jurisdiction in the court system, but one where she contributed in a way that was acknowledged by her peers as a very significant contribution, and in fact, which was recognised with an Order of Australia award. She also managed to undertake many community activities prior to her appointment as governor, and they included a term as commissioner of the AFL. Indeed, her allegiance is to Essendon, which is not so charming. But also was a director of the Melbourne Festival, which is such one of those landmark events that is so much a part of Victoria's strength as a cultural capital, as much as a sporting capital. Her contribution to the state has been manifest, and we could not have thought of a better person to actually tonight reflect on the importance of that petition 125 years ago that garnered 30,000 signatures from the people of Victoria pressing for this Parliament to take women in with the vote and to ensure that they had the equal rights in participation in our system of government and in creating the opportunities for future generations. Can I invite you, Governor, to the platform, and can I ask everybody else to warmly welcome the Governor on this occasion?
Well, thank you, everyone, and good evening. Might I start by acknowledging the Chief Justice, the Lieutenant Governor. It's lovely that she's here this evening. Of course, the Honourable Bruce Atkinson, President of the Legislative Council of Victoria, and I think you're charming, Mr. President, whoever you barrack for. The Honourable Telmo Languille, Speaker of the Legislative Assembly of Victoria, members of the judiciary, state and federal members of parliament, members of the consular corps and local government, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Well, first I join the president in acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we're meeting this evening, and I pay my respects too to their elders past and present and to any elders with us today. Well, what a pleasure it is to be here to help recognise and celebrate the 125th anniversary of Victoria's women's suffrage petition. There is a temptation amongst women of my age, and I realise that there are less and less women who fall into that category in any room that I happen to be in, but there is a temptation to believe that we invented feminism or women's liberation, or at least that we're at the vanguard of the women's movement. Well, tonight I want to say that if we succumb to that temptation, we are well and truly misguided. Yes, we were around in the late 1960s in the era of burning bras, although I've now discovered that my whole life I've believed that bras were burnt at the 1968 Miss America pageant in Atlantic City, and I discover that in fact they weren't, but it's a lovely thought that that's when it started. Whatever did happen, the women protesting at that pageant were certainly goaded into action. Just a short time before, a Canadian-born Orthodox Jewish woman, Shirley Firestone, attempted to ask a question at the Marxist-oriented National Conference for New Politics meeting in Chicago. The director, a man called William F. Pepper, apparently refused to recognise any of the women who were waiting to speak at that conference. When some of them, including Firestone, rushed to the podium to demand to know the reason, Pepper patted Firestone on the head and said, "Cool down, little girl. We have more important things to talk about than women's problems." Well, that was all that she needed, because it was Firestone who called together the women who had been at the meeting, and that was the genesis of the first women's liberation group in Chicago. The goading, though, didn't stop. There's a reference in the literature to an incident in the early 1970s when Thomas J. Hanahan, an Illinois legislator, whilst discussing the Equal Rights Amendment, brazenly described the protesting women there as braless, brainless broads. Some might say the goading hasn't stopped yet either, but I'll return to that. And yes, those of us activated in the 60s or the 70s read The Female Eunuch by Germaine Greer as one of the seminal works of our time. And we read Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex, even though it had in fact been published two decades earlier. The French were really well ahead. We celebrated that women started taking the leading roles in some countries, whether it was Golda Meir, Indira Gandhi or Margaret Thatcher. And we all sang along with Helen Reddy's anthem of the day, I am woman, hear me roar in numbers too big to ignore, and so on. And if we were old enough or motivated enough, there were many meetings and groups to join, including a particularly large Women's Liberation Conference in Canberra, held in May 1970. What I think many of us didn't do was to pause long enough to reflect that this wasn't in fact the first time in history that women had stepped up. We could go back as far as Cleopatra, one of the first state leaders in history, or Joan of Arc, one of the most famous female warriors, or Queen Elizabeth I, who ruled Britain, of course, for over 50 years through a period of great global unrest. Or within our own Indigenous history, Truganini, the Indigenous freedom fighter of the 1840s. We could also go back to the generation of women who preceded us, like Eleanor Roosevelt, who served as a United States delegate to the UN Assembly in the 1940s and was dubbed as the First Lady of the World by President Truman. Much closer to home, we can look to someone like Dame Roma Mitchell, who made a career of breaking glass ceilings. She was, of course, Australia's first Queen's Counsel, then first judge, female judge, the Chancellor of an Australian university, and the first female state governor. But what I think we must remember to do is to go back to those women who led the women's movement of the late 19th century. And I am grateful to both the Speaker and the President for prompting us to do just that by devising this recognition of the important 125-year commemoration of this petition. Let's just revisit 1891, the year of the petition. I'm not sure about any of you, but my recall of that year was a little shaky until I looked it up. Now, of course, it was historical detritus that came into view first. Details that really didn't help me, such as the fact that in February that year, it was the first ever shipment of asparagus that was sent to San Francisco, or that the Swiss Army knife was produced. But as I peeled back those sort of obvious Wikipedia layers that you might start with, the more serious stuff did emerge. Not only was 1891 the year that the ceremonial mace of the Victorian Parliament was mysteriously stolen, but it was also the year that the VFA Premiership was won by Essendon. Really, it was. Globally, 1891 saw the world on the cusp of commercial production of the first gasoline-powered automobile. It was the year that Edison patented the first motion picture camera, as well as what would become the radio. And London and Paris became connected for the very first time by telephone. So that sets the scene of that period in history. Melbourne was a city of 490,000 people. Victoria had a population of just over 1.1 million. We know that because, in fact, it was a census year in 1891. I should say that in case you want to search the census papers of the day, we also know that all surviving Victorian household census forms were destroyed to ensure for privacy that the names of the individuals were not kept or divulged. So some debates do seem to ebb and flow with the ages, don't they? The political climate of the time in Australia was one of ferment. The year had started with one of the earliest and probably one of the most important industrial disputes in the history of our state. The shearers' strike permeated every part of the first 6 months of 1891. But otherwise, the main political topic of the day by far was federation. The first constitutional convention was actually held in March 1891 to consider a draft constitution for the proposed federation. We know, of course, it was unsuccessful in obtaining any ratification at that point. But when it comes to women, what's referred to as the first wave of feminism was growing at different rates and different stages across the world. In the UK, it had in fact started in the 1850s with what was known as the Langham Place Circle and later the Women's Employment Defence League. They campaigned for the rights of women, specifically in education and employment. In the US, it had begun at Seneca Falls in New York in 1848, where a document called the Declaration of Sentiments was penned. When the leading social reformer, a woman called Susan B. Anthony, presented the group's petition to the New York State Senate Judiciary Committee, the members, all male of course, responded by complaining that it was in fact men who were oppressed because they did such things as giving women the very best seats in train carriages. So you can see it was a very high level of debate that occurred right there. Directly pertinent, actually, to women's suffrage, that same Susan Anthony found further fame when on 5 November 1872, she did something unthinkable. She cast a ballot in the US presidential election, even though women were not permitted to vote at the time. Naturally, she was arrested and subsequently found guilty of illegal voting. Victoria's first women's suffrage society, the first in Australia, was founded in 1884. Well, as in other countries, ours started being based on temperance and religion. And at first, it was connected mainly to equal voting rights. It wasn't until the late 1880s that the suffrage movement gained enough traction that it became national, and it extended to a rallying cry for equal justice, equal privileges in marriage and in divorce, and equal property rights in addition to the right to vote. It's interesting to note the backlash against the suffragists at that time. That may well sound like a familiar course throughout the ages. The powerful anti-suffragist movement emphasised the supposed defects of women in terms of their intellect as well as their temperament. The suffragists in particular were portrayed as trivial, selfish, weak, and too emotional for political vision. And oh yes, they were said to be bad mothers too. It's worth noting that one of the main objections raised to the prospect of women voting in elections was that it would provide married men with double the voting power. That is, the critics simply assumed that wives would blindly vote for whomever their husbands told them to vote, as you know we do. And so it was argued, apparently just as night follows day, that married men would gain an unfair advantage over single men at the ballot box if women could vote. An amusing sidebar that the President and I actually discussed at another function this morning is that some 26 years before the 1891 petition that called for women to receive the vote, some Victorian women had in fact already voted. The Parliament had made an error in the wording of the Electoral Act of 1863, with the unintended consequence that women could and actually did vote in the municipal elections of 1864. But there was no need to worry because the terrible mistake was promptly corrected by Parliament in 1865, so that voting was again restricted only to the male ratepayers and order to the world was thus restored. Against that backdrop, The creation of the Women's Suffrage Petition in 1891 is all the more remarkable. At a time well before universal suffrage in any Australian Parliament, a group of bold and determined women obtained what was then an unprecedented number of 30,000 signatures of women in favour of their cause. It was the largest petition in the world at that time. We can only imagine what size it might have been if men had signed too. They didn't. The monster petition, as it's known, comprises many fabric-backed sheets of paper glued together and rolled onto a cardboard spindle. It measures 260 metres long by 200 millimetres wide, and it takes three people 3 hours to unroll the petition from one spool to the other. In addition to being safely preserved, thanks to the combined efforts of the Genealogical Society of Victoria, the Royal Historical Society of Victoria, the Public Record Office of Victoria and the Parliament of Victoria, the women's suffrage petition has also been digitally transcribed and developed into a database. We're very lucky. This petition had many mothers. These women had taken to street corners throughout Melbourne, as well as going door to door, in order to collect the signatures to present to the Parliament. Some of the inspirational women who gave their time and energy to the cause were prominent women, like Jane Munro, listed on the petition as Mrs. James Munro, the wife of the Premier of the day, who actually presented the petition to Parliament, and Margaret McLean, of course listed as Mrs. William McLean, who was the head of the Women's Christian Temperance Union. Others, like Bessie Lee, were less well known. Bessie Lee was an interesting woman. She was born in 1860 at Dalesford. Her father was a butcher and a miner. Her mother died of consumption when Bessie was just 8 years old, and her father couldn't cope with the five children. He couldn't keep them together, and Bessie was sent to Melbourne to live with relatives. She was mistreated by them, particularly when they were drunk. She was given very little formal education, but she read voraciously and she found religion. Bessie immersed herself in social activism. She toured slums and refuges and jails, and she launched her own career of evangelical public speaking, most actively on temperance. She attracted a huge following amongst women with her writing and her speaking, and she had much of the pulling power, the star quality, in obtaining many of the signatures on the petition. She advocated that women would use the vote to, as she put it so beautifully, to shield the weak, to denounce the wrong, and in every way uplift and ennoble the individual and the nation. If we're talking about words, I particularly like the very simple words transcribed on this petition. It reads that government of the people, by the people, and for the people should mean all the people and not one half. That taxation and representation should go together without regard for the sex of the taxed. That all adult persons should have a voice in making the laws which they are required to obey. That in short, women should vote on equal terms with men. It's interesting, isn't it? Times change, ideas change, even languages change. But there's no number of inventions, computers, smartphones, or other gizmos or contraptions that could do better when it comes to language than those women did with those simple but unassailable words on equality. The sad fact is, however, that despite the words, despite the petition, and despite the efforts of those exceptional women, and although Victoria saw many firsts in the suffrage movement, we were actually slow in the ultimate achievement. It was in Victoria, as I've already noted, that the first Women's Suffrage Society was formed. And it was also in this Parliament that the first, albeit defeated a specific women's suffrage bill was introduced in 1889. And then it was just 2 years later that we achieved this monster petition, as it was called, the biggest in Australia. So you might say we started strongly, but the truth is we were overtaken by South Australia in 1895, and then by Western Australia, and then by New South Wales, and then by the Federal Parliament. The reality from which we can't hide is that it wasn't until 1908 that women gained the right to vote in our state. So that's nearly 20 years after that first vote about it in our Parliament. There were some 19 private members' bills for women's suffrage that were introduced but failed across those years. It was 17 years after the petition that we're celebrating here today. It was 13 years after South Australian women gained the vote, and it was even 7 years after Victorian women gained the right to vote in federal elections. Ironically, the Commonwealth of Australia was the first country in the world to give women both the right to vote in federal elections and the right to be elected to federal parliament. I should pause. I think it's fair at this point to note that it still wasn't until 1962 that Indigenous Australians, men and women, were formally given the right to vote. Now, I know I started my comments today in the mid-20th century, and I've gone backwards to look at the late 19th century. So with the same gay abandon of logic, let me now look briefly at the early 21st century to ponder the question, have we honoured the mothers of that first wave women's movement in the late 19th century in Victoria? Well, first, it took almost 80 years until what history now describes as the second wave of that movement that I talked about at the start of my comments tonight. That in itself probably tells a story. And if you consider that although Australia was the first country in the world to grant that simultaneous right to vote and right to stand for election that I mentioned, it still had the longest time span of all Western democratic countries between the eligibility of women to stand and their actual election, and that was a period of some 41 years. So it shows that we've probably made relatively baby steps between the first wave and the second wave. Indeed, by the time of that second wave of the women's movement in the late 1960s, we'd still never had a female Governor General, Governor, Prime Minister, Premier, or head of a federal or state department. Public companies didn't have female chairs, CEOs, or even board members, or if they did, you could have counted them on one hand. Throughout the 1960s, women still needed the signature of their husbands to take out a mortgage, and equal pay for equal work in the Australian public service was not enshrined, of course, until 1972. Worse than all of that, there'd never been a female director on the board of any club in the Victorian Football Association, the precursor to the AFL. You can tell just how slow the progress really was. So where are we in 2016? Because if the President and the Speaker will excuse me when I've been invited to talk about the suffrage to perhaps bring the history into the relevant part of today, I couldn't help but ask, where are we now? It is said that after the first wave of feminism at the time of this petition and the second wave in the 60s, that the 1990s had seen a third wave. So where have we arrived in this third wave, or towards the end of this third wave? Are we actually honouring those courageous women who fought so robustly for women's rights 125 years ago now? Well, some would say it's hard to be optimistic about the progress so far, when we see awful statistics worldwide and locally when it comes to violence against women. We know that more than one woman is killed in an incidence of family violence every fortnight in this country, and that many more are injured. We know that one in four women have experienced at least one incident of violence at the hand of an intimate partner, and we know that in some parts of the world, the figures are significantly more horrific than that. When it comes to the role of women, there have been many firsts and there has been some progress. We've had one female Prime Minister and one Governor General, one Victorian Premier and one Victorian Governor. Currently, we have two state departments headed by women. Women comprise one quarter of the Victorian judiciary, and I see some members of the judiciary here tonight, which is wonderful. Around 20% of board positions in ASX 200 companies, and about 5% of the chairs or CEOs in those companies. They're still low numbers, aren't they? They're very low numbers. And although we have one female jockey who's won a Melbourne Cup and one who does preside over an AFL club and so on, it's slim pickings when we count in the ones. It's also hard to be optimistic when we know that, amongst other things, women in this country still earn on average almost 18% or close to $300 per week less than the men. And it is hard to be optimistic when we see not just a drift in Australia, but somewhat of a global drift away from the attainment of parity. In 2014, the World Economic Forum predicted that it would take until 2095, they predicted it would take 81 years to achieve global gender parity. Well, just 1 year later, that's last year, in 2015, the prediction was blown out to 2133. That is a wait of 117 years, it's predicted, before we will see global gender parity. That's dismal. Moreover, Australia is actually ranked 36th in the world overall in gender equality. So it's countries such as Rwanda, the Philippines, Namibia, and Latvia who rank well above us, and obviously many others. We do need to do better. Research demonstrates what we all know, I think, by now, that there's a positive correlation between gender equality and GDP per capita. We know that boards, organisations, and governments with higher than average representation of women outperform those with below average representation. And given where we're standing today, it's probably reasonable to note that, as in very many other jurisdictions, women's representation in our parliaments does not nearly correspond to their electoral power. I think it's fair to observe that the issue of women and politics has moved from the issue of suffrage to an issue of equal representation. The recently composed 45th Federal Parliament has 32% female members. It's a rise on the 44th Parliament. It's a rise of 1%. And in our state parliament, only 47 out of a total of 127 members are women. The Honourable Amanda Vanstone has said that whichever side of politics they're from, the women in parliament want more women to join them. She posed the question to the women of Australia, "Where are you?" The fact is, she posed that question in 2002 when she was the Minister assisting the Prime Minister for the Status of Women in a speech then to celebrate the centenary of women's suffrage. Now 14 years on, and although there's been some progress, what the Honourable Amanda Vanstone said and asked then still resonates. And so the work must continue. We must work together, women and men, to honour what was achieved 125 years ago. And we can't let what some are now calling the fourth wave of the women's movement turn into the fifth and the sixth, the seventh and so on. To do so would diminish us all, men as well as women. And it would fail to honour the 30,000 women who, against the tide of the times, gave their names to a petition to achieve equal rights for future generations. I think we should all pause and imagine the feisty response of those women if they knew we had still not achieved that equality, and I think that would prompt us all to keep working. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor. I now invite the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly, the Honourable Telmo Languila, to make some comments.
May I begin by acknowledging the traditional Aboriginal owners of the land on which we are meeting. We pay our respects to them, their culture, their elders, past, present, and future, and elders who might be here today. May I say that the President and I are honored and humbled to be able to preside the Parliament which acknowledges our brothers and sisters at the beginning of every parliamentary sitting. We are also very honored and privileged to be able to say that we fly the flags of our brothers and sisters in Indigenous communities. Your Excellency, the Governor and Judge Howard, Mr. President and parliamentary colleagues, the Honourable Chief Justice and Honourable Members of the Judiciary and Members of the Diplomatic Corps, distinguished guests. Tonight we honour the brave and inspiring women of Victoria who 125 years ago collected 30,000 signatures calling for the right of women to vote. We also pay tribute to the pioneering women of our state who have walked in the footsteps of the petitioners, struggling for more than a century towards equality for women. As I said in Ballarat yesterday, I feel that those women made enormous progress towards equality in civil and democratic society. And I'm very confident that those women would have also supported people like me who were given the opportunity to come to this generous country as an asylum seeker and refugee. And importantly, the opportunity of safe haven, employment, housing, and education. I thank them for the work they did at that time. We also celebrate the role of models of our community who are here tonight and who inspire us with the work that they do for our state. Your Excellency, the Governor, we thank you most sincerely for your inspiring address to us tonight. It took 124 years from the time of the women's suffrage petition before we had the common sense in Victoria to have our first woman as governor. Your address tonight demonstrates why such an appointment was long overdue and why we are honored to have you as our governor. In your address tonight, you have taken us on a journey from the women's suffrage petition through to the challenges women still confront in contemporary society. It is a journey that is unfinished, and tonight is an opportunity to rededicate ourselves to the task of ensuring equality of opportunity within our society. Your address echoes the hopes of the 1891 petitioners, I quote, "The government of the people, by the people, and for the people should mean all the people and not half. And that all adult persons should have a voice in making the laws which they are required to obey," end of quote. Governor, in the audience tonight, we have many young Victorians and they will surely take inspiration from your example and from your words. Tonight, they also have the opportunity to hear from other role models. On behalf of the Parliament, the President and I would like to extend our thanks to the distinguished members of the panel who in the next session of this forum will discuss some of the issues raised in the Governor's address. Thank you to Murray Bumblett, Rohini Kapara, and Carol Schwartz for participating in our upcoming panel tonight, and to Santila Chingapai for taking on the role of our facilitator. I would also like to thank our two artists from Ballarat, Dashwansper and Pauline O'Shaughnessy Dowling for the wonderful sculptures that they have provided for the special exhibition in this hall. Each of our participants tonight honors the tradition of community service that was so evident among the 1891 petitioners. As I gathered the signatures for the petition, they would have heard many stories from women across the state who were so eager to be part of our state's story. I was interested to read recently one of the pamphlets of the era, which outlined some of the reasons women wanted to vote. It stated, and I quote, "As long as women cannot vote for members of parliament, they are not asked what they want and they are treated like children who do not know what is good or what is bad for them," end of quote. He said, "Laws which affect women are made without reference to women unless they get the vote." And it also said, I quote, "The vote is the best and most direct way by which women can get their wishes and wants to, attended to." Our legislators of the day missed their opportunity to make history. It is unimaginable now that there would have been such opposition to women's suffrage. But when you hear the words of those who spoke against the proposal, you understand the significant obstacles that the courageous petitioners faced. One member of the Legislative Assembly stated in 1891, I quote, "If we recognize that the best possible place for a woman is her own home, in attending to the education of her children, we must admit that she has quite enough to do without troubling her head about elections," end of quote. Contrast that with the words of the then Premier James Munro, who stated, "There is evidence that the influence of women will tend to elevate and purify politics. They are part of the people, and there can be no government of the people, by the people, for the people, which excludes them." It took far too long for our parliament to listen to those calls for equality. We must learn from the lessons of our past as we look at ways in which we can engage all of our diverse communities in the life of this parliament and this state. We celebrate the anniversary of this petition, not because it is an historical relic, but because it represents the will of a people who made an extraordinary effort to get their voice heard. Tonight, we are privileged to hear from another group of inspiring people whose contribution to this state we value with pride and admiration. Thank you. Thank you, Governor.